The following message by Pastor Dennis Clark and Dr. Jennifer Clark is brought to you by Full Stature Ministries and its supporters. For more information about Full Stature Ministries, please visit forgive123.com. That's forgive123.com.
The message title is No Reputation. Don't you like that? In Philippians 2, and this is what struck me this week when the Lord basically took me to this portion of Scripture. He says, let nothing be done through selfish ambition or conceit, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem others better than themselves. Let each of you look out not only for their own interests, but also the interests of others. Let this, and a good translation says, let this attitude be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but, say that with me, but made himself of no reputation, taking on the form of a bondservant. Let me be honest. When's the last message you heard on humility? It's been a while, huh? I've done it. Oh, that's why I asked that question. But in general, that is not a common message. It's one of the most unpreached messages. I feel like hope, people preach on love, they preach on faith, and they skip hope. And very often, they preach on a lot of other things, but humility is not one of them, is it? Probably because once you think you've got it, you lost it, all right? So it's probably one of those kind of messages. But in reality, what God really wants is to understand that when he says, have this attitude, this must be something we're able to do, correct? He's not going to tell us to do something. But when we would humble ourselves, God exalts. But I found that in making yourself of no reputation, I don't know, I'm sure all of you as believers have experienced this one way or another. In ministry, oh, you definitely get it. And if, I mean, you get judged on such a regular basis by so many different people. I mean, there's leaders that say, there's a lot of articles out there on me. There's more negative ones than there are positive ones. And that's commonplace. Because see, in the world, to find faults, and even in the church, we sometimes think that's a virtue. Some even call it discernment. But you can have it without even being a Christian, so it's not discernment to be a fault finder. But anyway, I'm more concerned with the fact that offenses will come, but how do we respond and how do we have this attitude that was in Jesus to make yourself of no reputation? How do you do that? And I believe that there's a brief lesson or a how-to lesson in the life of the Apostle Paul. And so I want to go to Philippians chapter 3. I see some patterns and some principles in there that if they're applied to our life, we can take heed to this word. Isn't that beautiful that the Apostle Paul, under the anointing of the Spirit, can still minister to us today? I just love that. I want that kind of substance in my life that it speaks long after I'm with Jesus. Where they can say, you know, I know my sister knows what that means because she ran from me and the gospel most of my Christian life. Even when she was in the hospital, I'd go visit her and she'd pretend like she was sleeping. Oh no, here comes my brother. He's going to be telling me about Jesus. All right. But what was really amazing is one of my best pupils. I mean, he could repeat my messages back better than I could. I mean, he just knew it inside out and backwards. He was just, well, my sister marries him. Make a long story short, she comes to the Lord, marries my best pupil, and now the rest of her life. I mean the rest of her life. She hears, well, you know, your brother used to say. So you can run, but you can't hide. God will find you sooner or later. He's going to get you. Can you imagine that? Oh, the divine justice. This is why God, if you just let things be, at some point in time, it will come together. This is true of your children. Some of you grieve over your children, your children's behavior, and you feel like they're going astray. Oh, but oh, I'll tell you what, when they come back, there's going to be music to your ears. You're going to hear things like, Mom, you were right. And you're going to go, oh, my goodness, I think I died and went to heaven. Mom, Dad, you were right. Huh? We've heard that. We've lived long enough to hear that. You might have to wait for it, but just remember, there is a day when it returns to you to bless you. So you cast your bread upon the water, keep it clean, keep your heart right, and make yourself of no reputation. Easily offended people basically lack the maturity that God really wants for us. And so really, you're going to have to learn how to make yourself of no reputation. And I think God worked on me as a young pastor from the very beginning. I had cult researchers attacking me because I was in the prophetic in the 70s. And I was I had dancing in my church. Can you imagine that? I mean, I took a beating for that. They just wouldn't let up because I had dancing in the church. And all of my friends, I was kind of eclectic. I had friends in different camps. And so when they wanted to attack me, they could attack me for all of those reasons because I had friends in all of those. It's interesting. I don't know if they attacked them. They probably did. But it was interesting that it was one of the key ingredients in developing me as a pastor. Because if you can't take it, if the fire in the kitchen is too hot, get out, you know. But in reality, almost all pastors and all leaders are going to face it someday, and they're going to have to learn how to respond properly. And Jesus gives us the instruction on how to respond. It isn't about your reputation. You keep your heart right with Jesus, and don't worry about what people say. People have a tendency when they don't have any facts, they fill it in with a guess. But that's true with not just leaders, that's true with you. They're going to do it to you. They're going to observe your behavior and come to a conclusion, and that is not discernment. That is pure and simple judgment. And if it's a brother or sister in Christ, it's the accuser of the brethren. God wants us to be, I think we ought to do one of those, what was that guy's name that said, you might be a something? Well, I don't know. We're going to kind of cover that at the end, where you might be a Pharisee if. Do you remember the Pharisees gave Jesus a lot of trouble, didn't they? But they were religious, and they were right, right? They were so right, they were wrong. Can you be so right, you're wrong? It's possible. But anyway, let's get the key on what God is trying to develop in us. Philippians chapter 3. Do you remember Paul's history a little bit, huh? He basically was out persecuting Christians, killing Christians, having them executed. And it was in a religious zeal. So don't tell me he didn't think he was doing right. He wasn't just some kind of evil person. He basically was deceived by religion and attacked Christians. So in verse 3, or in Philippians 3, verses 1 to 14, finally, my brethren, rejoice in the Lord. For me to write the same thing to you is not tedious, but for you it is safety. The safety is you've got to get joy in your heart. You've got to get to the place where you rejoice regardless of circumstances. One of the most fundamental scriptures that changed my life, and it'll change your life, was found in Colossians, where it's basically said, being steadfast and patient with joy. And then God broke that up in little pieces for me. Steadfast and patient with joy. He said steadfastness refers to all the circumstances in your life, good and bad. Patience has to do with all the people in your life, the good and the bad. So I'm going, steadfast in all the circumstances and patient with all those people with joy. If that doesn't take a supernatural act, I don't know what does. You can't do that in and of yourself, could you? If ever you hear a message that's too hard, it's because you're not taking the divine enablement of God's grace and his ability to allow you to do it. So let's humble ourselves and say, I can't do that in and of myself. I cannot be steadfast in all circumstances and patient with all people without humbling myself to the lordship of Jesus. Is that true? This is good humility. So I make myself of no reputation. To make myself of no reputation, it's God's reputation that I'm concerned with. Finally, my brethren, rejoice in the Lord. For me to write the same thing to you is not tedious, but for you, this is a safety. Beware of the dogs. Now, there's a warning here, but he's also telling you to rejoice. So rejoice, but while you're rejoicing, I'm going to warn you. Beware of the dogs. Beware of evil workers. Beware of the mutilation. For we are the true circumcision, to where the change took place in the heart. The circumcision of the heart. The heart that is the attitude that was in Christ Jesus. We worship God in the Spirit. We rejoice in Christ Jesus. And here's a key. We have no confidence in our flesh. I was surprised how many people take confidence in their flesh, their accomplishments, and what have you. And they almost like they need the title, or they need a certain accomplishment or achievement to feel good about themselves. I want God to make me feel good about myself when I consider that it's basically his intrinsic value that he placed on me. And look at the price that he paid to even to save me from my sin. Oh, the love that he had for me. That should be the attitude. But God's basically saying no confidence in the flesh. For though I also might have confidence in the flesh, if anyone else thinks he may have confidence in the flesh, I'm more so. How's about that? So if you think you're a big shot, he says, and if that's where your confidence is and that's where you think you're special, he said, I was circumcised on the eighth day of the stock of Israel. I was of the tribe of Benjamin. I came from a tribe full of kings, were in my ancestry. I was a Hebrew of Hebrews. Concerning the law, I was a Pharisee. Concerning zeal, I persecuted the church. That's how well I did my Pharisee job. If you want to get credentials. Concerning righteousness, which is by the law, I was blameless. But those things that were considered gain, these I have considered loss for the excellency or for the sake of knowing Jesus Christ. So when he says, yet if I indeed count all things lost for the excellence of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and I consider them as rubbish. So where he was highly exalted and spoken well of by men, with his prestige, with his credentials, with his heritage, all of those good things, he basically says, that stuff is rubbish compared to what I found in Jesus. That I might gain Christ and be found in him, not having my own righteousness from the law, which he said he was blameless, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith. And then the most life-changing verse that God ever ministered to me, verses 10 and 11, that I might know him, that I might progressively become more intimately acquainted with all the wonders of his person and his resurrection, the fellowship of his sufferings. You know, fellowship of his sufferings is not, it's not you rejoicing in sufferings. It's the sufferings that he said was basically he laid down his life to let the Father be exemplified through him. The real sufferings of Christ is when you lay down your flesh life and find the higher life by allowing God to express his personality through you. There is still a major weakness in the church when we talk about who I am in Christ. When you listen to people tell you who they are in Christ, they can quote the scriptures, but it still sounds to me like a big I and a little C. It should be a big I am Christ living through me. It is no longer I that live, but Christ that lives through me. There's a big difference if it's a big Jesus and a little you, as opposed to a big me and who I am. Do you see how you can even take scripture and make it self-centered when it's supposed to be God-centered? So let's learn from the Apostle Paul in Philippians 3:12. This is something that ministered to me when I still had red hair. That's how long ago. I mean, this is a long time ago. Philippians 3:12. I wanted to emulate the way the Apostle Paul spoke. Thank God I still have some. Not that I have already attained or that I am already perfected. I just love that because you know what? No matter what his accomplishments were in the natural, no matter how much, and he did accomplish a great deal for Jesus. I mean, think of how many epistles have been written by the Apostle Paul. What vigor, what vitality, what passion. But yet he says, Not that I have already attained or I'm already perfected. What I love is the humility with someone with great accomplishments saying, but I haven't arrived yet. I'm not done. I am not going to not stay full throttle, full speed ahead because I haven't arrived yet. I just love that attitude. And I saw four elements here. And the first one was called the inward look. Now, when I say the inward look, I'm not talking about navel staring. I'm talking about being God searched. And God, in the inward look of letting God look on the inside of him, said basically, I haven't arrived yet. How many can honestly say, if you're going to make yourself of no reputation, then you better admit that you're not done yet? Because you know, one of the worst things you can say in church is, I already knew that. That in itself is an indication that you haven't arrived yet. Do you know there are people that you know that you know that you know you could take them to another level or that you could give them something of value and they sabotage it by saying, I already knew that. I took a course years ago. I learned that years ago. I took that years ago. Most of the time, they don't know what they know. And they sabotage growing in greater grace and knowledge of the Lord Jesus. You want substance, not information. Don't ever be deceived by knowledge over substance. So I saw there's four elements here. If you're a note taker, you can write it down. It's the inward look, the backward look, the forward look, and the upward look. The inward look, the backward look, the forward look, and the upward look. I think if we're going to make ourselves of no reputation and just be little love slaves of the Lord Jesus, we need to allow God to search our heart like this. Don't you? Don't you think? That this was a healthy evaluation of a powerful man of God who did it wrong and did it right. Learned from what he did wrong and said it's rubbish. All that prestige, all the titles, all of that heritage, all of that, it's rubbish compared to the exceedingly great reward of Jesus himself. Galatians 2:20, that it is no longer I that live, but Christ that lives his life through me. But look at this. In the inward look, he says basically, brethren, I do not count myself have to apprehended it. I have not arrived yet. That's the inward look. That's the God-searching look. That's the God saying, you know what? That I have purpose in this life, and I'm moving toward that purpose. But this one thing, boy, you wanna make yourself of no reputation and be and God says, he that honors me, him shall I honor. 1 Samuel chapter 2. He that honors me, I will honor. You want to be honored by God. Don't worry about what man does. You don't need man's honor. You don't need his approval. You need God's approval, and you need to honor him because he that honors me, him shall I honor. And the way to start that is exactly the way the Apostle Paul did it right here. But one thing. Women like lists, but men usually better just give them one thing. All right? So I don't know if the Apostle Paul would have been a woman. I don't know if he would have said this one thing. I would hope so. But there's no list here. There's just one thing. And you know what I found out? Men or women, seek first the kingdom of God. This one thing. So apparently, one in the Greek and in the Hebrew means one. So, this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind. There's the backward look. Can you, in fact, make yourself of no reputation and forget the things that are behind? Now, this is not saying I can't remember some childhood hurt or pain. That's not what that's referring to. His backward look is I'm saying I'm forgetting my accomplishments, my credentials, my prestige, my heritage. I am forgetting all those accomplishments. I'm making myself of no reputation. I'm just a little love slave of the Lord Jesus. I'm just a little servant of the Most High God. my El Elyon, the Most High God. And I am forgetting those things which are behind. And you know, you could even do that with spiritual accomplishments. He says to be healthy and say, I've not yet arrived. I'll tell you what, if you cling to too much to your current accomplishments or past accomplishments, even in the church, I've heard people say, oh, I wish it was like the good old days. Well, maybe you have selective remembrance. The good old days weren't necessarily so good. Huh? And even if they were, you weren't necessarily, right? The good old days. I don't want the good old days, because the tender mercies of the Lord are new every morning. Great is his faithfulness. I want to enter into the new. I want to rejoice that everything is brand new, and that I am moving from faith to faith, glory to glory. Huh? I want to move to another level. I don't care about the old days. That was a lower level. I want to go toward the convergence and seeing all the good things that God is going to do, and the things of the places of obedience. There's also a reaping from the fruit of that obedience in the days ahead. I'm looking forward to that. So I see that this apostle had an inward look that was healthy and made himself of no reputation. He forgot and made himself of no reputation by forgetting all of those past accomplishments. In the spirit, in religion, it doesn't matter. In the world, let it go. There are some people that are totally devastated unless they have a title. I've been to churches where people wanted the title so bad they didn't want to do what the title said. They just wanted the title. I had evangelist so-and-so, but they never evangelized anybody. But they just needed that title. I'm sorry, that's sad. Everybody should be an evangelist. Not in the office of an evangelist, but for heaven's sakes, we were called to the ministry of reconciliation. So just live there and make yourself of no reputation. There's a balance even with titles. Titles, you can enter into false humility where you never would dare take a title. And then you can exalt a title. You can go either way, can't you? Truth is the tension between two extremes. And really, what you really need to do is make yourself of no reputation. If that's in the heart, it won't matter if you use the title or you don't use the title. You'll be who you are with no reputation, first and foremost, a little loved slave of the Lord Jesus. You know, some people don't like that word slave, but in reality, the little loved slave was a bond servant. It was voluntary service. It was not mandatory. Nobody made them do anything. The inward look, healthy, no reputation. One thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind, the backward look, no reputation. None of that stuff is, I can't take it with me anyway. God's not going to judge me by those things. He's going to judge me by how much did I love with my life? That's going to be the bottom line. How much did you love with your life? Not how many ministries did you establish. How much did you love with your life? And reaching forward to those things which are ahead. Forward. There's a forward look. He had an inward look, a backward look, and now a forward look to those things which are ahead. You know, the scripture that the Lord impressed upon me, and even as a very young believer, was that without a redemptive revelation, or without a prophetic revelation, or the way you may have heard it in most translations, without a vision, the people perish. They cast off restraint. If people without a forward vision, that means they're probably trapped in the past, or the present is overwhelming them, circumstances and people. But if a people perish or cast off restraint, or one translation says, without a redemptive vision, the people run wild. That made more sense to me. Because basically, that's what Jesus warned of in the end times. Many will say, did I not prophesy? Did I not cast out devils? And he says, depart from me. I knew you not. That's insult enough. You who work lawlessness. So without a redemptive vision for your life, you stand in jeopardy of being in the lawlessness and lack of intimacy. Because God preordained plans and purposes for you, and it always included the church. It always included other people. There's no such thing as destiny without other people. That's called selfish success, and the world can do that. But in the kingdom, destiny will automatically produce success. God wants you to prosper, but he also doesn't want you climbing over people and using people to get where you need to go. God says, I'll make room for you. You get your heart right and you obey me, and I'll put it together. I've heard many stories of people that were in the same situation I was, this young believer. I got off drugs and welfare and took a job for less than welfare, get my life squared away, and I was willing to do anything. I didn't need a title. I had a college education and still was, that's where drugs and stuff took me. And when I got off, God sent me to a place to work for less than welfare. I knew I would lose benefits, no hospitalization. I know the trap. There's a trap. I'll take care of you. If you want to live there, that's not security. But God basically, out of that obedience, continually blessed. I didn't do that job for cleaning toilets and mopping floors, sitting in classes where they taught me with a college education, they taught me how to say, when you fill out an application over here, you mark down male, M-A-L-E. You know how intimidating that is? But you know what? I got myself there. And if God was real, he was going to get me out of there. So I cleaned toilets, and they were the Lord's toilets, and I felt the joy of the Lord while I was doing it. I'm going to tell you something. There's supernatural events that need to take place in people's lives, but you got to make yourself of no reputation. You know, I could have sat there and said, I'm just going to wait till my ministry falls out of the sky because, after all, I got a college education, and I did this, and I did that, and I did this. You can sit there forever. There's people that are still, they're traveling, they're doing all kinds of stuff, and it's not ministry, it's a vacation. Until God gets a hold of your life. There's too much being done in the name of missions that's not missions. I'm sorry. Missions means you're actually helping other people, not helping yourself. There's a big difference. This forward look to those things which are ahead. You need vision. Without a redemptive vision, the people cast off restraint or run wild or enter into lawlessness. And don't say because you can prophesy or because you can cast out devils, because you move in the gifts of the Spirit. Those people gave that argument to Jesus and he didn't accept it, did he? Did I not cast out devils? Did I not prophesy? Depart from me, I knew you not. God wants an intimate relationship. He wants a little love child. He wants you to be his love child. He wants sons and daughters more than he wants big hot shots, really. And he wants you to be able to do ministry to where you don't care who gets the credit. Have you ever done ministry where you don't care who gets the credit? Because if you've done that, you've become part of something bigger than yourself. The forward look. Without a vision, the people perish. Do you know what God's called you to do? Are you even orientated? Do you know if you hit your head and you went to the emergency room, they would not let you out if you couldn't tell them who you are, where do you live, and what do you do for a living? I'd keep them, wouldn't you, if I was a nurse or a doctor, and they couldn't tell me what their name was, where they live, or what they do for a living? They're disoriented. How many believers are disoriented? They don't know who they are in God. They don't know where they live. They don't know where home base is. They don't know where their family is. And they don't know what they do for a living. They're looking for a niche. Why not just be a little servant of the Lord Jesus, be part of a team, and just do whatever? I know this is shocking to do whatever. We've done whatever, right? You look in that bookstore, look at some of these products are around the world, and we're so excited about the fact that it's touching so many lives. But then behind the scenes, if you had a little nanny cam, you could see Jennifer on her hands and knees by the side of a couch putting those CDs and DVDs together. See, people don't see that. They don't see that. Oh, you got to order ink. Oh, you got to get the computer fixed. Oh, everything crashed. Oh, you're good. My knees hurt because I'm on the floor kneeling beside the couch putting CDs. CD number one, CD number two, CD number three, then burn them, then package them, then put the thing in. I'm so proud of her. She works early in the morning till late at night. And without her, I'm nothing. You know how I know that? Because my pastor friends told me that. And I trust their opinion. At least they prefaced it with, Dennis, we love you, but without her, you're nothing. And they knew me longer than her. So it's got to be true. But she knows without me, she wouldn't have nothing to write about. So there, we need each other. And that's true for the body at large. We need one another. Each part gives and receives. Don't evaluate it by earthly standards, evaluate it by kingdom standards. God's looking for a one accord that goes beyond all of this. So I really believe that right now the word of the Lord is some people got to get a vision, a redemptive vision of, do you have a spiritual father in your house? Do you know who they are? Because I'm getting to rejoice now after all these years of sowing into people's lives and not seeing them for a while, and then they're on their own. And now going up to Connecticut, I've got people that I've seen, that I've known, that I've worked with, that I walked a flourishing church in Connecticut where the first 3 years, I can remember, he probably watched it, the first 3 years it was like, I'm a fraud, I can't do this, I don't know, I don't feel like I'm a pastor, I don't know. Because the pastor of the church, who was a good friend of ours, had a massive heart attack and died early at 45 years old. And he was mentoring this wonderful couple. And he even sent them down here for me to check them out. He says, check out this couple because I think I'm going to work them into the ministry. I said, did you ever tell them? And he goes, no, I'm not telling them. And then he died. And I got to tell them that he loved you, was mentoring you, and expected you. But it was still awkward to be thrown into a position. That church is flourishing now in Connecticut. It's a wonderful church, River of Life. And it is a river of life. But our friend founded it, but now spiritual sons and daughters are pastoring it, and we're going up there. But after we go up there, it's not only him and her and watching them stand on their own 2 feet and expand the kingdom of God. And he doesn't need my help now. He's good. I could use his help. That's the beauty of it. It's like your children come back to bless you. You sow into them, but they come back, and they are a blessing to you. That's what parents live for. They're going to even come back and say, you know what? You were right. I love that. Right, Jennifer? Doesn't that the music to your ears when your kids come back and say, you know what, Mom, Dad? I don't care if they hate to admit it or not, but at least if they say it, but you know what? You were right. It's just like, it does something. I can't explain it. Unless you have it happen, you won't know what I'm talking about. But anyway, that vision for the future, we're going up this weekend. You pray for us because I'm probably going to sit and sob. But I've got sons and daughters that I've met and worked with and sons and daughters that I never even met that are going to show up. And they're coming from all over the country just to go to Connecticut there. And I am just thrilled. People I hadn't seen for years and some I've never seen in person. It's so fulfilling. I want that for you too. I want you to get so mature in your Christian walk that you have Timothys that someday are going to come back and bless you. Everybody, if you're going to be a mature Christian, you should have a Paul in your life. You should have somebody over you. You should have a Barnabas. You should have peer level. I had for years, I met with a half a dozen pastors for 20 some years on a weekly basis. That peer level does something to sharpen. Huh? And straighten you out, keeps you from making some bad mistakes. But everybody's got to have Timothys. Everybody needs a Timothy. And if you're a single person, you need a Timothy. And you're not going to like it. Single people, I love single people, but they don't like this statement that I'm about to make. Ready? Drop down, get your peace. Self-absorbed single people. All right? I mean that with love. Self-absorbed does not mean selfish. It just means that while you're single, quite frankly, it's only you you're looking out for in reality. There's a growth spurt that takes place as a single person. Good thing to do is get married, have kids, and those days are over. But until then, you pretty much do whatever you want to do whenever you want to do it. Be honest, right? How about starting now and really maturing by taking somebody under your wing? Because there's a fulfillment in that, right? Single people, if you've done it, right? Most of you, because most of you have that kind of DNA that you would have done it. And you start investing in other people, and there's a feeling. I don't care if they're little orphan children. I don't care if it's someone you hardly know. There's something about investing in the life of someone else that does something beneficial for you. I had one guy, he never forgot that statement. I said it one time, so I figured, well, if the shoe fits, wear it. I mean, if you're still talking about 6 months later, self-absorbed single people, maybe you're a self-absorbed single person. And you know the funny thing is? There are people that are self-absorbed. They have a need to be seen and heard, but they don't serve. I want you to think about that. You might be a Pharisee if you cannot serve anybody other than yourself, but you do have a need to be seen and heard. You might be a Pharisee if, all right, we're going to get into that a little later. But right now, the inward look, the backward look, the forward look to those things which are ahead. How many need to find out from God, who am I, where do I live, and what do I do for a living? Where's home? Where do I live? You know, we're living in the day of conference junkies. That's wonderful. I like to be an eclectic and to be exposed to various ministries. But that is not the same as having roots. You can be a tumbleweed and never really grow because you've been relationally deficient. You've been exposed to a great deal, but relationally deficient. You don't grow until there's relationship, both with God and with man. Everybody needs roots. Where there is no redemptive revelation, the people cast off restraint. You ought to write that verse down and just let God speak to you on it. Proverbs 29:18. There is an efficacy of the grace of God, and the grace of God is not some just unmerited favor. It's the ability to obey. It's the power of God to obey. Grace is to obey. I've been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. The life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not set aside the grace of God, for if righteousness comes through the law, then Christ died in vain. Now, Jennifer told me that the German pronunciation of this, I've been saying it wrong for 30 years, so I'm going to say it right one time. Galatians 2:20 and 21 in the WUST translation. WUST, W-U-E-S-T, WUST. That's not the way I'd say it. With Christ, I have been crucified, and it is no longer I who live, but there lives in me Christ. And that life which I now live in the sphere of the flesh, by faith I live it, which faith is in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself on my behalf. I do not thwart the efficacy of the grace of God. For if through the law comes righteousness, then Christ died for no purpose. I believe that what God's saying with the grace is that he's basically saying, I've given you the divine enablement to obey. I don't want your sacrifice. I don't want your religious actions. I want obedience. As you obey, these things will come together and bless you. All right? So I want to make this second part of Philippians 3:10. For the rest of my life, I'm zeroing in on the second half. I've spent 40 years on the first half, that I might know him, that I might progressively become more intimately acquainted with all the wonders of his person. But we're entering in a season now, and I know that a lot of it will be to make yourself of no reputation in the process, but that I might so share in his sufferings as to be continually transformed in the spirit into his likeness, even to his death, in the hope that if possible, I may attain to the spiritual and moral resurrection that lifts me out from among the dead, even while I'm in the body. I love that. That's my epitaph for the rest of my life. The first part is included, but the second part is that there is an out resurrection. And the sufferings are nothing more than choosing the higher life over the lower life, making yourself of no reputation, and allowing him to express resurrection life through me for the days ahead. That kind of suffering is a death to my flesh while I'm in this body. Death to my flesh, that resurrection life might come forth. That's what's going to bless people. People want life. They don't want more teaching. They don't want more information. And certainly, they don't want secondhand information. They want something that has life in you and has changed your life, has become substance. Preach substance, because substance can be deposited. Paul said to Timothy, that which I entrusted into you, that which I have put as a deposit in you. That means you caught it, Timothy. You didn't just learn stuff. You caught it. And now, because you caught it, you can deposit it in the lives of other people. That's what I'm wanting. That's what I'm living for. Philippians 3:10. In the WUST translation, for his sake I've been caused to forfeit all things and count them but dung, in order that I might come to know him in an experiential way, to come to know experientially the power of his resurrection and the joint participation of his sufferings, being brought to the place where my life will radiate a likeness to his death, if by any means I might arrive at the goal, namely, of the out resurrection from among those who are dead. I can understand some of the great revivalists now for the first time with a little greater clarity. It was like, I'm just going to go preach the gospel, and if people, whether they're interested or not, they can come and watch me burn. I believe that's what the fire of God will do on the inside. Let people just watch you burn, because you are torches for God. You are the light of the world. You are children of light from the Father of lights, and you're supposed to be emanating that light. I believe that it's getting God's identity. We shared this in two messages, and God keeps pressing this on me, so I think this is caught more than taught. But it's not who you are in Christ. It's Christ getting his personality through you. That means you must decrease as he increases. So instead of trying to discover who you are, why not discover who he is? And that will be self-explanatory. Jesus said to Philip, have I been with you this long and you want to see the Father? If you've seen me, you've seen the Father. That's no reputation. That's no reputation. Let nothing be done through selfish ambition or conceit. And here's going to be the formula, because the formula that's necessary to start living this and expanding in this is Matthew 5, 43 to 48. How many are willing to try this before I even say what it is? All right. Matthew 5, 43, it says, you have heard it said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies, bless those who curse you, do good to those that hate you, and pray for those who despitefully use you and persecute you. That's the telos, the charge, the purpose, that you may be sons of your Father in heaven. Whoa. So part of our inheritance to reflect him as sons and daughters. And by the way, you can't be a father to sons and daughters until you've been a son unto the Father. This is part of the character quality. But I say, you say, love your enemies. I mean, love those that love you and hate your enemies. I say, bless those who curse you. Pray for how many are willing to do that? Bless those that curse you. Pray for those who despitefully use you and persecute you, who hate you. I've always made it a matter of private prayer to release blessing and intercession and pray in tongues for everyone that's ever said anything about me that I heard about. I'll tell you what, that's just healthy. You don't have to be their best friend, but it's healthy. Because it's going to happen, whether it's in the marketplace or church or whatever, it happens. Somebody's going to watch an action and interpret you. But in reality, I saw that the formula for God was to be like your Heavenly Father, to be perfect like He is perfect. But you know what that word perfect means? It means complete, and it means inclusive. Bless them that curse you. Pray for them. Inclusiveness is being a son or a daughter unto the Father. What did the Pharisees do? Look at that Jesus. He drinks with the tax collectors and all of that. Huh? And they felt in their own righteousness, they were exclusive. They were so exclusive and so right that they excluded Jesus. Huh? I believe. Let's get to the little Pharisee test. We'll have some fun with this, right? Everybody smiling? All right. We're going to conclude with this. I think this is fun. You might be a Pharisee if you are secretly pleased with yourself when you compare yourself to other people. We shouldn't laugh now. If you have that, you just go, oh, Jesus, I'm sorry. I receive forgiveness. All right. Keep the atmosphere clean. There's only 20 of these. That was number one. Number one is you are secretly pleased. That means you don't tell nobody, but on the inside, you thank God I'm not like them. Okay. You are secretly pleased with yourself when you compare yourself to others. You might be a Pharisee. You ignore your little sins, but judge the big sins of other people. Yeah. They blew it big time, but you're not part of the redemptive solution. You just gossip with your little sin of gossip. Okay? But it sure made you feel better that, thank God that wasn't me. You might be a Pharisee. You don't serve other people, but you want to be a big shot. You need to be the center of attention. You need to be a drama king or queen. You need to be seen and heard. What's the third one? You ready? We're going to make it through 20? Four. I don't smoke, I don't drink, and I don't chew, and I don't hang with those that do. I just judge them. Isn't that something? I don't smoke, I don't drink, and I don't chew, and I don't hang with those that do. But I do judge them. You might be a Pharisee. Martin Luther drank beer. Charles Spurgeon smoked a pipe and cigars. And Jesus drank wine. We've got some very serious issues here. The standard, you might be a Pharisee, number five, if the standard you use to judge others is you. That's scary, huh? Number six, you might be a Pharisee if you have a great memory for all your good works. You know when it shows up? When somebody doesn't do what you want them to do. And you go, after all I did for you, you might be a Pharisee. Because you were doing it unto man, not unto God, right? After all I did for you. Anybody ever heard that? Anybody ever say that? You might be a Pharisee. Because if you did it as unto the Lord, you basically learn to let it go, that you're sowing into the kingdom. You know how many people's lives I sowed in that turned around and dissed me, you know? And I don't feel no hurt, no pain about it. I just feel sad for them because they don't know. I'd have loved them anyway. There was a whole lot of people I would have mentored, but they wanted what they wanted, when they wanted it, and how they wanted it. But you know what? The ones that didn't, I'm going to see them this week. And I'm so proud of them. And it's so good to invest in people's lives and see them stand on their own two feet and impact the kingdom. Come on, you guys. You need to get some Timothys. Find some Timothys that you can pour into, because everybody needs a Timothy. Number 7. You have a great memory for the sins and shortcomings of other people. You might be a Pharisee. I can remember in 1927 when you weren't even born in 1927. Yeah, I know, but I heard someone say that. All right. If you've got that good of a memory for sins and shortcomings, you might be a Pharisee. And I would recommend you release forgiveness. It's a little long. That was a long time ago. Okay. Number 8, you might be a Pharisee if you gossip about people, but you don't pray for them. Do you know that the biblical response to seeing anything wrong, if there is really something wrong, is to release loving intercession on their behalf? That's what you would want. Or would you want people just talk about you and say, you know, so-and-so, you know, psh. What would you rather have? I'd rather have them pray for me. Then you should do likely. Do unto others as you would have them do unto you. You like to look good to others. This is number 9. But ignore your bad attitudes. What would we call that? In church, we would call that, you put on your church face. You're nice in church, but boy, you're hard to live with. But you're nice to those church people when you're there. You know, you got to put the nice face on for about an hour and a half. Then you go home and that real you comes out. I can remember when the Lord dealt with me the first time, because I was getting a little bit proud of my prayer life. Spent a long time in prayer in my office. And one day, Jason came and knocked on the door and goes, Dad. And I went, what? And I went, whoa, I think I better stay in here a little longer. There's a bear in that cave. He better stay there until he mellows. It was like, you're interrupting my time with God. Well, you know what? That's a Pharisee. And God really convicted. That's right. You might be a Pharisee if you regularly complain and find fault. Just complainers. That's Pharisaical. Fault finders. Number 11. Oh, I've seen this in little Bible studies. You are proud that you're right and that others are wrong. Ah, I just love straightening those people out. No, you're wrong. I'm right. You can be so right, you're wrong. But that's okay. You're right, and it makes you feel good. You might be a Pharisee. Number 12, you call your ability to see faults in other people as discernment. That has to be my all-time favorite. Any unsaved person could do the same thing. It's called observation, studying body language, looking at expressions, taking words and putting your own meaning to them, never knowing by the Spirit the heart in which those words came from, or the intent, or the motive, or the source. You applied your own framework to it. And that's the accuser of the brethren. Number 13, you try to make yourself look good by putting others down. That has never worked for me. When someone's putting someone else down, that does not make them look bigger. It's just like that's the way they talk about me. You do not make your light shine brighter by putting out someone else's. That's the perfect example of a Pharisee. Thank God I'm not like that. Indirectly is what you're saying. I'm above that. When you compare yourself, number 14, when you compare yourself with other believers, you believe you are better than them. Number 15, you feel your anger is justified when other people are wrong. What did Jesus say? Besides calling him a brood of vipers. Did you know that the one thing Pharisees were really good at was gnashing their teeth? I'm not even sure how gnashing of your teeth works, but they were good at it. Every time Jesus did something, the Pharisees were gnashing at their teeth, and they were indignant and angry. One of the signs of a Pharisee is an anger problem. And then you get righteous about it. Look at him. My favorite one was Simon. Jesus got Simon the Pharisee right where it hurt. He said, if this Jesus were a prophet, this is Simon thinking to himself, he'd know that woman was a prostitute that's down there washing his feet with her tears and drying them with her hair. And a Pharisee. And Jesus said, Simon. And the King James, seest thou this woman? Simon, you see this woman? When I came in, you didn't even give me a customary greeting that was due anyone. You didn't even give me that. This woman has not ceased to wash my feet with her tears and dry them with her hair. Oh, her sins are many, but her sins are forgiven. What about you, Simon? What about you who stand in judgment? It's so easy. It's easy to be a Pharisee. You believe, number 16, you believe you really please God by keeping all the rules. I've seen people that really had meltdowns through the years. And their meltdown showed and revealed the heart that needed change, because they go, why did God let this happen to my child? And why did God let this happen to my husband and my wife and my mother and my father? Why did God let this happen after all I've done for him? Therein lies the problem. After all I did for him. You might be a Pharisee if you have that response. How many have seen that response? As a pastor, I've certainly seen it on multitudes of times. They get mad at God. Many are not in church because they're mad at God, like he did something wrong. No, you had more confidence in what you did in the flesh. God doesn't want your sacrifices, he wants your obedience. Number 17, we used to call this the pride of sophistication. You might be a Pharisee if you try to be close to leadership to feel important. Just want to hang around leadership to make you look like maybe you're more important without any merit on your own. You want God's approval, not man's approval. That's the pride of sophistication. People would say, I went to Harvard. I went to name some big church. I went to so-and-so's church. But you know what? That doesn't tell me how much you learned. You might have been the deadhead in that church. You might have been the one that never got nothing out of that church. So don't give me that pride of sophistication. I went to so-and-so. My first thing is, did you graduate? Did you learn anything? What did you accomplish personally? Don't give me titles. People do that all the time. I've never been here before, but I was part of so-and-so Cathedral on the West Coast with famous pastor. A congregation of 30,000. All right, well, where did you rank in that 30,000? What did you do? Who's your father? Who's your pastor? Oh, I can't talk to him. Oh, so whenever you did anything, you just did whatever you thought you ought to do. Never bounced anything off of anybody. No, but you're part of. Okay, I get it. You might be a Pharisee if you draw close to leadership just to feel like something. 18, having a title is important to you. Title should represent your function. What's the catch word there? Function. That means you're actually doing something. Okay. 19. You might be a Pharisee if you are a people pleaser and not a God pleaser. And that's going to be key. To make yourself of no reputation, everything you do it as unto the Lord from the heart. And you can live with persecution. You can live with people's opinions. I've had to do it. And I look backwards now and I think those are some of the best years of my life. When people disagreed, didn't like this, didn't like that. That was the best formative years for me anyway. Maybe not pleasant, but formative and important and significant. Because I can remember the ones that used to hurt was when they judge you by an external action because they really don't know you by the heart. And I can still remember that one man that I would not let in the nursery, that I had a third of the church in an uproar. But I had heard from other pastors, he has a record, and he was a pedophile. And my responsibility was he wasn't going to go anywhere near the kids. And I was the mean pastor that wouldn't let that nice man in with the children. And you know what? I'll take that any day. I'll take that any day. But you know what? That is part of life, though. Because what people don't know, they fill in with a guess. Every person that leaves a church angry has something derogatory to say. And I never chase people that leave because that fortifies their rebellion. That is not the good shepherd going after the lost. They're not lost. They know exactly where they are and what they're doing and where they're going. But they usually, very rarely, have ever brought face to face anything a pastor's done in any church to the pastor. They almost invariably go and tell somebody else. And offenses must come, but woe to them by which the offense comes. I don't want to be a stumbling block to anybody. Neither should you. They're inevitable. Offenses will come. But don't go filling in blanks that you don't know. Make yourself of no reputation. Don't feel like you have to defend anybody. You don't have to defend me. You don't have to defend yourself. Just glorify Jesus with your heart and your life and let the pieces fall where they will, because God will bring together the things that need to be together. Do you know even division in the church can be a good thing at times? An unpleasant thing, but a good thing. Sometimes until the lot leaves, God can't say, now lift up your eye and see Abraham, because Abraham loved Lot. But lots can't be mentored. Sometimes lots just need to leave. When they separate, because there's strife, and God wants the unity. Amen. Let them go. And don't chase after them. However, I've even had people in my first pastorate, when I was only pastoring about 2 years, had one woman that was so indignant, well, I'm out of here. I ain't coming back. But you know darn well if you come back, he's going to forgive us. That's a good testimony. You know darn well if we come back, he's going to forgive us. You know that, don't you? I'm saying, you know what? Then I at least got across what needed to get across. But I want a kingdom life people to live what we preached, the full stature message, that we would be a prototype, not a perfect people, not an elite body that's better than anybody else, but mature enough and complete enough to be inclusive enough to bless them that curse you, pray for those who despitefully use you, and make yourself of no reputation. And the last one, number 20. Ready for this one? You might be a Pharisee if you're insulted by the notion that you might be a Pharisee. I close with that. But let's pray. Everybody's had people talk about you, and it's not been just. And I'll tell you what, some of you in the flesh want to go and fix it. Don't go fixing it. You don't need to fix it. Reconcile, that's a good thing. But don't go trying to fix it. If people gossip It's like feathers in a pillow. It's all over the place. It spreads like cancer. Don't go try to collect the feathers. Don't try to over-explain yourself. All right? Reconcile where you can reconcile, but don't try to fix it in the natural. So, Father, right now, in the name of Jesus, we as a corporate group of imperfect people are going to be complete and inclusive. I bless those who curse me right now, knowingly and unknowingly. There's people that can flash in my mind that I know, and there's people that I don't know. What's the difference? I am releasing out of my belly loving forgiveness. I am a forgiven person. Jesus paid a great price to give it to me, and I'm going to be like my Heavenly Father, and I'm going to release forgiveness to everyone who's ever cursed me, judged. I bless them that curse me. I pray for them who have used me for their own means. And in ministry, you see it a lot. In the workplace, you see it a lot. Father, I release and pray for them that have used me selfishly, thinking that it was to their own selfish ambition and conceit. They moved in that attitude. I have the attitude that I release them. Look at my Jesus. I mean, he had a thief in charge of the finances. And at the last minute, even when Satan had entered Judas's heart, he was still reaching out in friendship, in a gesture of friendship to him. I release that kind of love. That's the kind of love my Jesus have. And I bless them that curse. Pray for them that despitefully use. Bless them that hate me. And do good. Do good to all. Father, then we will be, I like what it says then we will be like sons and daughters of God. Then we're going to be like him. Let's be like him. Let's have this attitude that was in Christ Jesus. That's quite a need for grace, isn't it, to have that attitude and to maintain that attitude? It's going to take the anointing of God. So, Father, I want to receive that anointing, share in the fellowship of your sufferings, so that resurrection life can come out of this death-doomed body, out of this mortal body while I'm still in this body. Resurrection life's going to flow from me, and I bless them that curse. Pray for them that spitefully use. Do good to them that hate you. All those that speak all manner of evil against you, I release the blessing of God upon them, known and unknown, in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen.
You've been listening to Pastor Dennis Clark and Dr. Jennifer Clark of Full Stature Ministries at forgive123.com. Full Stature Ministries reserve all copyright protections under applicable law. Our copyright policy is available at our website, forgive123.com. For more information about Full Stature Ministries and additional life-transforming materials, please visit forgive123.com.